Good evening, Lauren Heiser here. Welcome to another Blender mini tutorial. For those of you who've just watched my second Blender mini tutorial, you'll recognize our scene. What we have is a plane which is emitting particles which are affected by a vertex and which then are also affected by a spherical force field attached to an empty. Now, what we want to do is we want to create a path and then animate this force field moving along that path, either to represent a pedestrian moving along the path, vehicular traffic, a boat moving past our site. What we'll do, I'll change to my top view by pressing the 7 key on my number pad. I'll zoom out, and I'm going to use my grease pencil. I still have my tablet. I tend to use it for everything. It's a lot easier than a mouse once you get the hang of it. And I'll just, let's go red. Draw mode is turned on, sketch in 3D is turned on, and I don't know what that is. I can erase that by using the bottom of my pen and tablet. I don't know how you can do it with the mouse. I think you have to do the right mouse click. Now, if I just click and let's draw a path here. Now, what we want to do is we need to convert this to a path. So convert to path. Now, normally we've been converting to a Bezier. We want to convert it to a path. Let's just turn off the grease pencil and you'll see it's drawn a path here. Now, if I click on that path, I'll move it up the Z-axis. Notice how it's saying that it's Z0, but obviously it's not. It's because it's created the center of our model here at 0, 0. So what we'll do is we'll tab in like we did in the last tutorial and right click on this point here. I'll probably do it at that point. And now we'll move our cursor to the selection. Now we'll move our center point to the cursor. You'll see here now it's location Z value is -7. So I'll change that to be 0. Now, what we want to do is we'll just right click on our spherical force field here, we'll move it around, and I just press the G key. Now you'll notice I want to keep it in this X and Y plane, and to do that, I can either go X, move down here, and then go G, Y, or, being lazy as I am, I go G and I press Shift, Z, and that means I'm now locked to the X, Y plane, so I can move anywhere I want over here, you know, have a look there, and it's in the X, Y plane. So G, Shift, Z. Say I wanted to move in the Z, Y plane, I do G, Shift, X. See, and I'm moving in that plane. You'll notice here, I'm actually pressing the middle mouse button on my mouse, and it's snapping to whatever axis I am hovering over. Blender can do has three or four different ways of doing things, and it can get quite confusing sometimes. So anyway, move it over here. Now what we want to do is we want to tell this force field, or this empty with a force field applied to it, to follow this curve that we've done. Now to do that, I select my empty with the force field, and I press and hold shift and I right click on, pardon me, on the curve, and then I do control P. And you'll see here it'll say make parent. Now there's normal parent, follow path, curve to form, path constraint. Now what we want to do is we want to follow the path. So if you click that, and now if I press Alt A, you'll see my curve, my force field is following the path. Now by default it follows it at 100 frames per path. I'll show you how to change that first, but first we want to move our curve, so it's our emitter, so it's actually on the curve. So I'll tab into my curve and I will right click on that vertex there, not really vertex, control point on the curve. I go Shift S and I go cursor to selection. Now I right click on my empty with the force field applied, and I go Shift S and I go selection to cursor. Now when I go Alt A, it will move along the curve much smoother. Now, what I want to do is I want to slow that down. I want it to be 250 frames because that's the default animation we're using. I'll right click on that, on my curve, You'll see here in Curve and Surface under the Edit tab, it is Path Length, Path Len. Click on that, change that to 250, and it will move along that path at 250 frames. Press space, you see, it's shooting it down. Now let's say I wanted to change it back to zero. Let's say we create in the top view here. We'll create a ISIS. Create a monkey head. There we go. Zoom in. Rotate him around the x-axis 90 degrees so it's facing the right way. Now I want to apply, I want the monkey head to be following this path. So I do the same thing. I select the monkey head, right, press and hold shift and right click and select the path and do control P and do follow path. Now if I do Alt A, you'll see he's moving along. What we'll do is we will once again move the 3D cursor to that selection. Notice when I tab into it, it still remembers I've selected that vertex. Shift S, cursor to selection, tab, right click on the monkey, Shift S, selection to cursor, and you'll notice it's lined up that midpoint of my monkey head to where that cursor is. Now if I undo, I tab into the monkey, let's click on that bottom vertex down there, just the bottom, go Shift S and I move the cursor to that point. Now if I tab out of my monkey again and I'll change the center point of my monkey, center to the cursor. See how the center's moved down there? Now I will select my curve again, move my cursor to that point, click on the monkey, and move the monkey to the cursor. Now you see, the bottom of the monkey head is on the curve. Now all that's left is to rotate the monkey along the z-axis so he's facing where he's going. Now if I do Alt A, you'll see that monkey is going along the curve. Now you can do this with any object, but you can also do it with cameras and lights. Now, let's say we want to animate or film the monkey's perspective. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to split my screen here by right-clicking on the division between the two screens, split area, and I'm going to change this one to be my camera view. So I'll press the zero key on the number pad, or I can go view camera here. Now I want to right-click on this camera, and once again I'll go Shift S and I'll go selection to cursor, and it's going to move to where my cursor is. Hang on, let's zoom in here. Now, because I just want to see this screen here and not the other one at this moment, I will press Control and Up on the keypad. So Control and the Up key. Now if I toggle Control and Up, it will take whatever window or area of the screen I'm hovering over and will maximize it. So you can even do it to this little guy. No, you can't. You can do it to that one down here. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but maybe you would. So now, zoom in. Notice it's put, what I'll do is I'll do B select to just select these guys, and I will press the angle key on, oh sorry, the divisor key on my number pad to just isolate them. So I just want the camera and the monkey. I'll isolate them too. So that makes it a bit easier just to work with my camera and my monkey. Now I don't want to look from his chin, I want to look from his eyes. Now if I tab into the monkey, I'll right click on that vertex and I'll right click on that vertex as well, which are the ones at his eyes. Now what we'll do is we'll do Shift S again and we'll move our cursor to the cursor to the selection. So it'll move that 3D cursor at the center of anything you have selected. So if I had, what we'll do is I'll press A and select all these vertexes and go cursor to selection, it moves it to the middle of that. But I don't want to do that. I just want to get the two eyes here. Shift S, cursor to selection. There we go. Now I right click on my camera, and I think you know what I'm going to do. Shift S, selection to cursor. Now I press Control up again to see everything. And you'll notice that in this screen, I can only see the monkey and the camera. While in this screen here, I can see everything else. That's because the isolate view, which is the divisor on the number pad, is view specific. So I'm going to click on that camera. Now I want to rotate the camera. I'm going to zoom in, see it's not. Press the home key again. Notice how I was having problems zooming in, so I pressed the home key. Now I want to rotate the camera, but he's not in line with the XY axis. So to rotate it, if I just did the R key, see, it's going to be a bit wonky. I want to rotate around the normal of the camera, which is, it'll rotate around wherever the center point of the camera is, happens to be there. Now I need to turn on my gizmo. You'll see here it's global, so it's going on the global XY position, which is this one here and the Z. Now, if I change that to be normal, it will be along the normal of the center of the object. So now if I change that to be rotate, and I click on the X axis, you'll see here we go. It's rotated it up, change that to be 90. Turn on unlock, 90. So now, if I click on this view, let's do Control up. Control up, and do Alt A. It animates the monkey moving along because I forgot to attach the camera to the monkey. Turn off the gizmo. To do that, you click on the camera, Shift and right click on the monkey, do Control P to make it apparent. So that means it's the parent of the other. So when one moves, two, Alt A, here we go. We now have monkey camera. See, that curve is a bit jittery because I did it as a grease pencil. I probably wouldn't do that. Well, there you go, guys. Let's get back to this. That is how you can have objects following along a path. So you notice how it's influencing the particles that are being emitted as they go. How you can create a monkey camera. How you can make a monkey follow along a path. How you can change the time it takes to follow this curve. Let's change it. Let's make it like 679. And it'll be going a lot slower. So we'll have a different outcome. Oh, thank you very much. Hope it helped. Happy blendering.